So this is Jette Wagen. This is the second video in a series of videos on using QGIS. And this second video, we will be talking about data entry, import, and simple editing. And we'll be going over adding raster files, georeferencing, creating new vector files, creating new vector data, and editing attribute tables. Now, before we start with that, a couple of things about coordinate reference systems. As I mentioned in the last video, here down the screen we have the EPSG indicated, which is actually the European Petroleum Survey Group, that indexed coordinate reference systems and numbered them for easy identification. If we click on that, the project properties will open on the tab of the coordinate reference systems, and you can see that we can choose different systems for our map. Now, just very quickly, the coordinate reference system actually consists of two components, of which one is the actual coordinate system, so the method we use to identify specific locations on the Earth curved surface. And the projection system is the method with which we transform those 3D, three-dimensional locations onto a Cartesian, and usually two-dimensional plane in which we can work in a way that we are used to when it comes to geometry in terms of distances and angles and areas and so on and so forth. These projections can never be a perfect representation of the Earth's surface, so there will always be a little bit of distortion, and there exist so many different projections because every projection has its own specific purpose and its own specific geographical location in which it tries to minimize distortions. Now, as you can see for this project, I have selected WGS84, which is the most common used coordinate system at the moment, and I have chosen UTM zone 33N projection, which is universal transverse Mercator, which is in this case optimized for what we do in Italy. So that's why I have this one selected. Just as a quick demonstration what using different coordinate systems means, I will get some data on screen that is of a very large geographical area. So I have here made a connection to a source which is called a web mapping service, which is an online service that that countries and institutes, etc., can serve, through which you can find all kinds of geodata. And in this case, this is the Italian government that uses this to disclose information on the geology, soils, geomorphology, etc. of Italy. So I made a connection. This is an online service, and this data is being downloaded at the moment you use this data. So I again can simply drag the data into my layers panel, and you will see that the data is very quickly downloaded, and you'll see the map of Italy. Now, take a good look at the shape of the map, and take a good look at what happens when I choose a different projection system. So let's go to the WGS84 without the UTM projection, but with its own default projection. And if you paid attention, you can see that the shape of Italy changed. So it's a bit more diagonal, it's a bit more compressed from north to south. You may imagine that in this way, the distances and angles and areas of all those shapes, all those polygons that describe the geology of Italy are also a bit different in this way. So you may imagine that the coordinate reference system that you use has influence on your project and on the results that you can get. And in this case, just to show the differences also and source of potential errors when it comes to coordinate reference systems, is when you zoom in, and let's say we want to know the coordinates of this red speck over here. Look at the coordinates here down the screen, and you can see decimal degrees indicating a location in the WGS84 reference system. Now, if we would switch back to the UTM system, I will press enter. Okay, now again, you see that things changed here. But you can also see that if you now again place your cursor on that location, you can see here in the coordinate window down the screen, you can see that there are completely different numbers, which are actually the numbers that refer to the sheet 33N north of the transverse Mercator system. Now, you may imagine that if you have data that has coordinates, but you don't know which coordinate system it is referenced, your data may end up in a very wrong place. So specifically when dealing with data that you get from other sources, it is very important to understand in what projection system they are, or what coordinate reference system is used, so you can successfully project them over on top of each other in your GIS on their correct locations. And if this doesn't happen, then 9 out of 10 times the problem has something to do with a missing or an unknown or a wrong setting about the for the coordinate reference system. So okay, that was very quickly something about coordinate reference system. I will switch back. Yeah. I already had it selected, okay. I will throw out this the Carta Geologica because we don't need that, okay. What we will now do is load these two aerial photographs into our GIS. And again, here you can see TIFF. If we would look on the hard disk, you would see that there are actually two files, of which this is a TIFF world file that actually contains the coordinates of these two files. But here it is conveniently displayed as a single file. We will add them, and here they are. Now, these are also both referenced in the WGS 84 UTM 33N projection, and you can see the coordinates in the coordinate window, and indeed these are the coordinates that we saw of the range, fall within the range that we know from this projection by now. Now, what are we actually looking at? These are two aerial photographs of the area surrounding the ancient city of Satricum, which is roughly this terrain. We are looking at Borgo-le-Ferrière, a small hamlet that's basically built next to the ancient Acropolis that we see here, of which the remains of a temple with several faces are, well, more or less, the outlines are more or less visible here. Okay, so what we want to do now, because we have these aerial photographs which are quite accurately displaying the situation as it is now, but we also have this reconstruction.tiff. And this reconstruction is a map that has been made a couple of decades ago, using old methods and mapping the area in a time where Le Ferrière were basically three buildings, and with quite a different geomorphology, as you can see. So it's actually quite interesting to see what the researchers, the archaeologists that made this map, where they thought that the extent of the site was. We can see here the old excavations that are not visible anymore in the field, and we might want to know what the extent of those excavations precisely were. So it's basically interesting to project this map over our aerial photograph so we can start making comparisons and build up our spatial database on Satricum. So what we will do is, and this is just an illustration that has no geographical coordinates. It has no place in space, so to say. And we have to give it that place. We have to put it in the right place in our GIS. And this process is called georeferencing. So how do we go about that? We have to, let's first just give an example of what happens if we would just add it as it is. Okay, so this is add existing raster layer. So, and here it is. Now you must know that if you, and this is different from ArcGIS, but QGIS makes you pre-select the type of file you're looking for, actually. So if you select another file type, you simply don't see the TIFFs, which can be very handy if you have folders with an enormous amount of files. You can also just click all files, which is also fine, of course. And then you see the world files, actually, but we'll just go back to selecting the TIFF. Where are you? There it is, GeoTIFF. Okay, we select this to add it to our system. We have to say, well, this is projected in the system that we use, so we press OK. But of course, it doesn't appear here because it simply does not have coordinates defined to the file. So this is now floating somewhere in space, and we actually want to have it in the right location. So this is not working, so I'm going to throw it out again. The process of georeferencing is a bit different than in ArcGIS, so that's why it's very useful to understand and see how this works. Now, the georeferencer in QGIS can be found in the raster menu. This was a couple of years ago when I first used it. It was still a plugin that you had to download, just to demonstrate how QGIS kind of developed. And we'll open the georeferencer. Okay, we'll add the map to the georeferencer. Okay, UTM zone 33N, and you can already see that we indicated just now when we opened it for the first time that projection system, and that's now stored in the XML file here. So there's already starting to build up some geographical information. But now what we have to do is place it on its right location. Now, how does this work, georeferencing? It is quite simple, actually. You indicate points on the old, well, let's call this old map. We indicate points on this map, which we will also indicate in our GIS where we think it is the right location. And then if we have at least 3 points, we can actually shift it to that location. So let's go about it. I know that this angle in the road is actually still existing. Just a couple of words. I mean, obviously, when this map was made, there were less advanced techniques for mapping in geographical information. So it may very well be, depending on who this map made and how, and et cetera, it may very well be that this is not a very good map. It may be not very accurate. You can also see that the scale is quite rough, so probably lines here can be much more thicker than they are if we would look at the aerial photograph. And you may also imagine that, of course, there are things on this map that are not there anymore. So georeferencing all data like this can have all kinds of problems that will lead to inaccuracies in your eventual overlay, which is not a very big problem per se, depending on what you need to do with it. And we are also not going to try to make a perfect match in this case, because that's not the goal of this video. So I will just use 3 points, project it, so you can see and understand how this process works, but expect it to be not very accurate. Okay, I know that this band still exists, as I said. If I click on that, I can enter map coordinates. If we would know the location in terms of coordinates, we can do that. We don't know that. Map from map canvas. We will zoom to our aerial photographs. I know that what I just clicked on the old map is the same as this angle. We click OK. Okay, now let's take another point that is probably still possible to find. Let's take this southeastern tip of the Acropolis, and I'll click on that. And I'll go to map canvas, and there you are. So that should be basically more or less this point. Okay. Yeah. And then finally, we are going to use this little bend in the road here, this little nick. Go to map canvas, and I should say that it is more or less here, but I think this, you can already see that the nick in the road here is much less sharp than it is here on the map. Okay, we have now 3 points. We could go for the georeferencing, just 2 points. First of all, here you see the ground control point table, which is indicates the source X and Y and the destination X and Y coordinates. It shows you the difference between them, and it also shows you a residual. And the residual actually is an indication of error. So the residual shows how much internally the old map will have to be distorted, or if you don't do it, how far off the indicated locations of the map they are going to be. If we would now transform it, and you see it, these red lines actually mean that these points on the old map will shift in locations that are among themselves not really coherent, and therefore there will be a residual error. If you would try to make a perfect match for this map, you would try to minimize the residual error as much as possible. We are going to leave that for now as it is. And the second thing I want to mention is the transformation settings. The transformation settings are the, basically refers to the method of transforming the old map, in as much as it needs to be done to get it on the right location. At the moment, it says linear, and a linear transformation basically means that the only thing that JS will do with this old map is it will move it, obviously. It will rotate it, and it will scale the map. It will not distort the map. It will not tear at the edges. It will not try to rubber sheet it. It will not cause any internal distortions in what we see displayed on the map. Of course, you might want that, and with old maps, often you have to go for some kind of rubber sheeting technique. But in this case, we are going to keep it at linear. But here you can choose a lot of different transformation types, which are actually different mathematical or geometrical processes that transform the locations on the map. In your old map to the new situation, and this new situation, of course, is indicated by your ground control points. Okay, we'll leave it at linear. We'll say go for a transform. It was successfully georeferenced, so we can close this now. We don't want to save the ground control points, and now we want to add the raster file to our GIS again and see what happens. So I'll take it. Yes, it's going to be UTM-33N. And there it is. Now you can already see by me moving through the GIS that it's more or less in the right place. We'll use transparency to directly compare the two. There we go. Okay. Well, there you have it. Now, clearly, so I already tried to prepare you for this is by no means a perfect match. Yeah, it is not really accurate, the location. We could now try to optimize it to get it better, located better on the map. You can see that it probably should rotate a little bit more, but it will never be perfect. And you would have to use some more advanced transformation techniques to get it more perfect. But it is not the purpose of this video to get this perfect. It is the purpose of this video to show you how you should go about it. So we'll leave the georeferencing now for what it is. What I want to finish with is to show you how you can create new vector data, also a process called digitizing, and how you can add data, modify data in the attribute table. So let's just, for the sake of an example, say that we want to look up some locations on the old map in the actual field. So we're going to pretend that this is perfectly referenced. And let's say we want to know where on the Acropolis, as we would go there now, are the extents of the old excavations that are displayed on this map. What we could do is we could place points or draw the borders of the excavation. And we could put those coordinates in a mobile GIS on a tablet, or we could just use a GPS device. We could even enter them into a total station and then map them exactly. But we want to have the coordinates of these locations. And therefore we have to place points in the GIS from which we could get the coordinates. And we also want to describe those points so we know what we saw in the GIS before we took the data and went to the field. So we're going to make a new vector layer. So that's this button. New shape file, type point is perfect. We are going to select the correct CRS. And immediately here, this part of this new shape file layer screen allows you to create new fields. So we can actually already start creating the attribute table. So let's create a few fields. Let's say we want a name, and we want a source. There you go. We say, okay, that's fine. Now we have to find a place to store it, of course. We're going to throw it into the folder. Let's say lookup points, and we're going to save. There you go. Okay, you see that the layer appeared. We can set it to editable, as I showed in the previous video. We can select the tool to add new features. And now we can simply place points by clicking on the location on the map. Now let's say we want the western extent of the excavation, so I'll give it an idea. As soon as you click on the map, and this is also different from our GIS, a form immediately pops up that allows you to directly enter data into the attribute table, which is really convenient for digitizing actually. So we'll give this a name, let's say western extent, and we'll say the source is the old map, and we'll press OK. Now let's say that we also want to see the eastern extent, and let's say that this would be the eastern extent of the excavation. So we'll say, hey, now the idea, of course, too, and then we'll say eastern extent, and we'll say old map. And there you go. Okay, now we have two points. We'll save it. Look in the attribute table. And indeed, we see that our two points have two rows connected to it. We can select them using the attribute table. And actually, let's suppose we wanted to add a bit more information. Well, the attribute table here allows you to directly do that. So we could, for example, toggle editing mode. We could say new field. What would we say? Well, accuracy, for example. How accurate do we think that the location indication of a location is? We'll make it a text field. We'll say length is 80, and there you go. Now it's editable, so we can directly enter our data, our information into the attribute table. And well, we actually think that this is very bad. And this is also very bad. So now we have the data stored here as well. Oh, it didn't save the last one. Probably I had to give it an enter. Exactly. Now we can save it. We can toggle editing off. And there you have it. Now we have a bit more information in the attribute table. Now, this attribute editing, you can do very much with it. Just what very interesting feature that you might also know from ArcGIS is that you have this field calculator by which you can do all kinds of operations on the field. You can take all this textual information. You could, if you want, for whatever reason, combine it into a new field, but you can also work on the on numeric fields, do calculations, etc., etc. So the field calculator is a very versatile tool for that. Okay, so just to repeat, what we did is adding raster files, georeferencing. We created a new vector file. We created some vector data, and we looked at the attribute table and how we can use that to add new information to our features. Yes, that's it for this video.